Hello and welcome to the Commander's Quarters, your Magic the Gathering source that helps you command your budget. This show and episodes like this one are possible thanks to viewers like you. If you're looking for an easy way to help support this show, make sure that you like, share, and subscribe. Also, hit that bell notification icon so you don't miss any new episodes. You can also go check out our playmats and other merchandise at thecommanderscourters.com. Another easy way to support this show is with our TCG player affiliate links. So whether you're buying a deck or individual cards, you can use this general link right here or one in the description. And the final way that you can support this show is by supporting us directly by becoming a patron. There are many benefits to being a patron, and I truly couldn't do this without all their support. There's even a brand new Brigadier General tier where you can get a shout-out on a Commander's Quarters episode that's dedicated to you. Hello and welcome to the moment that you've all been waiting for, the Golden Pig Awards Ceremony for Innistrad Crimson Vow. Or should I say Innistrad Crimson Vow plus the Innistrad Crimson Vow Commander Precons. Throughout spoiler season, commanders have been competing for this incredibly prestigious award. And although there are many worthy commanders, only one can hold the title of the Golden Pig of Innistrad Crimson Vow. The winner of the Golden Pig Award will of course receive the Golden Pig, which is most definitely made of 100% pure gold. Obviously. This award will of course be cherished and displayed by the winner of the Golden Pig forever. Now just a quick note before we start with the runners-up. These picks are 100% based off of my own opinions. I'm selecting my favorite commanders from this set and the pre-cons based off of their design, and your opinions on these commanders might differ, and that's okay. These picks are based off of which commanders are my favorite, not which are the most powerful in the set. That is a completely different episode where I go through the tier rankings, and that will come out in a couple of days. And just one more thing before we jump into this episode, a big thank you to Eddie for all the great discussions around these commanders, and throughout all of spoiler season, and yeah, thank you Eddie, but also if I make any mistakes in this episode or any other episode, make sure you blame Eddie because it's always Eddie's fault and not mine. And now with all that said, let's jump into it. So let's get things started off at number 10. And coming in at 10th place, we actually have one of the pre-con commanders with Millicent, Restless Revenant. Millicent is a 4-4 spirit soldier with flying for 5 white blue. She has this spell costs 1 less to cast for each spirit you control, so although she does have a high converted mana cost, she's not going to cost you all that much. Especially since she also has whenever she or another non-token spirit you control dies or deals combat damage to a player, create a 1-1 white spirit creature token with flying. So yeah, the more non-token spirits that you have deal combat damage to players, the more spirits that you get in play, and again, the more spirits that you have in play, the cheaper Millicent is to actually, you know, recast if she's ever dealt with. Spirits have really been looking for a spirit tribal commander for a while, and Millicent checks a lot of the boxes. There are a ton of low-to-the-ground spirits that are incredibly effective in these colors, so yeah, get them out, get Millicent out, start swinging, get more spirits out, and yeah, if Millicent's ever dealt with, or if your team's ever dealt with maybe a board wipe, those spirits get replaced, and then you can easily recast Millicent. So this commander, in a way, is kind of like board wipe insurance, on top of also just being a way to grow your army incredibly quickly, and a way to also get Millicent itself back out really quick. So yeah, again, a commander like this can definitely utilize a lot of low-to-the-ground spirits, and there are a ton of fantastic ones like Toppelgeist, Remorseful Cleric, and Rattlechains. Toppelgeist just might be a 1-1 flyer for one, but when it comes into play, you can tap down a creature, and then you can also tap down a creature at the beginning of each opponent's upkeep if you've got Delirium Met. Remorseful Cleric is already a 2-1 flyer for two, and if you need to sacrifice it to exile cards from target player's graveyard, you can. And then Rattlechains has Flash, Flying, and when it enters the battlefield, target spirit gains hexproof until end of turn, so you can protect something, and it also lets you cast other spirit spells as though they had Flash. And again, all of these are just 1 or 2 mana spirits, and they do a ton of work for you. Speaking of which, there's also Supreme Phantom, which is a fantastic spirit lord that gives other spirits you control ++1. And then at 3 mana, you are paying 1 extra mana for Drogskull Captain, but you're getting some extra value because it gives other spirits you control ++1, and on top of that, Hexproof. So yeah, again, a lot of really fantastic low-to-the-ground spirits help this commander out, and some other cards help you out like Reconnaissance Mission. It says, whenever a creature control deals combat damage to a player, you may draw a card. So yeah, again, you're going to be incentivized already to attack players and deal combat damage to them. So now you get some extra card draw with all those spirits that you're going to be making. So yeah, just overall, I really like the design of this commander. I think it's a solid spirit tribal commander that, again, is basically board wipe protection, or again, I should say board wipe insurance more so, on top of being able to just build you an army and help you just recast your commander again if you need to. So Millicent, congratulations on your number 10 placement in the Golden Pig Awards. And now it's time for us to move away from number 10 and on to number 9. And coming in at 9th place, we've got a very different commander from our Spirit Tribal Commander with it's kind of similar because it's a Sea Monster Tribal Commander, or at least it can be, with Runo Stromkirk / Kroppus, Lore of the Deep. On the front side, we've got Runo Stromkirk, a 1/4 Vampire Cleric with flying that costs 1 blue-black. When Runo enters the battlefield, you can put up to 1 target creature card from your graveyard on top of your library. And at the beginning of your upkeep, you look at the top card of your library, you may reveal a card. If a creature card with mana value 6 or greater is revealed this way, transform Runo Stromkirk. It transforms into Kroppus, Lore of the Deep, a 3/5 Flying Kraken Horror that has, when it attacks, create a tapped and attacking token that's a copy of another target attacking creature. And if that creature is a Kraken, Leviathan, Octopus, or a Serpent, basically a sea monster, you create 2 of those tokens instead. So again, you do not have to build this Sea Monster Tribal, but you get an extra benefit if you do, getting a second token, and yeah, that is a ton of value, especially again on this 3-mana commander. Yes, there is a requirement to actually flip it, but that one can be pretty easily met. I mean, you could just brainstorm, draw 3 cards, put 2 cards from your hand on top of your library in any order, so put that creature with converted mana cost of 6 or greater on top of your library, and reveal it and flip your commander. Or you know, you could get a big creature into your graveyard for your commander to get back on top when it enters with something like Chart of Course. It says draw 2 cards, then discard a card unless you attack with a creature this turn. And of course, there are a lot of fantastic creatures to pick from, again, especially in something like Sea Monster Tribal, like Scourge of Fleets. It says, when it enters the battlefield, return each creature your opponent's control with toughness X or less to its owner's hand, where X is the number of islands you control. So essentially, with this in play and your commander attacking, this is a repeatable board wipe. Again, you basically just get more token copies of it, getting that trigger again, and bouncing your opponent's creatures. Or you know, you could just keep getting copies of something like Stormtide Leviathan, an 8/8 Leviathan with Island Walk that says all lands are islands in addition to other types, and creatures without flying or Island Walk can't attack. So obviously your commander can still attack, and so can this, and yeah, you just keep getting copies of this and getting, you know, massive 8/8s into play, swinging at your opponents, and they probably can't attack you back. Or although Gyruda is legendary, you can keep getting copies of it to keep getting its ETB. When it enters the battlefield, each player puts the top 4 cards of their library into their graveyard. You put a creature card with an even converted mana cost from among those cards on the battlefield under your control. So yeah, getting that ETB multiple times in a turn can be really effective. Speaking of effective, of course, if you are running a Sea Monster Tribal deck, definitely run Whelming Wave. It's going to bounce all creatures except for Krakens, Leviathans, Octopus, and Serpents. Basically, bounce all non-sea monsters. Regardless, yeah, Runo Stromkirk is definitely a very interesting commander, and yeah, a very fantastic one for Sea Monster Tribal. And again, you don't even have to build Sea Monster Tribal if you want to build, you know, other creatures that maybe have massive ETBs where you only care about getting, you know, 1 token at a time. Do that as well. So yeah, Runo, or should I say maybe more so Kroppus, congratulations on your 9th place finish in the Golden Pig Awards. But now it's time for us to move away from number 9 and up one more spot to number 8. And we're moving away from sea monsters and onto, well, a frog with Grawlnok the Omnivore. Grawlnok is a 3/3 frog, like I said, that costs 2 green blue. It has, whenever a frog you control attacks, mill 3 cards. And whenever a permanent card is put into your graveyard from your library, exile with a croak counter on it. You may play lands and cast spells from one card you own in exile with croak counters on them. Now, Grawlnok actually might be the kind of commander that people actually automatically dismiss because they think, well, because of that first part, this has to be a frog tribal commander, and I just really don't want to build around that. But actually, even without that piece, this is an incredibly powerful commander that can generate an insane amount of value. Essentially, if you build a Moldrotha-style deck around this that is pretty much all permanents and working to self-mill yourself, well, you are going to get a ton of things into your graveyard, and yeah, you get access to all of them. So most definitely utilize permanents that mill you with things like Perpetual Timepiece, Jace's Eraser, and Fleet Swallower. Perpetual Timepiece can tap to mill yourself for 2, Jace's Eraser has whenever you draw a card, you may have player mill 1 card, and Fleet Swallower, well, this one gets pretty fantastic with its frog friend. This fish says when it attacks, target player puts the top half of their library rounded up into their graveyard, so basically, mill half your library. Again, with Grawlnok in play, we get croak counters on all those cards, and we get access to those cards as long as Grawlnok is in play. And of course, since we have access to those lands as well and we can play them, let's use some things that let us play extra lands like Druid Class. Simply by leveling up to level 2, we can play initial land on each of our turns. And since we're getting more and more lands into play, maybe we want some landfall triggers like on Rampaging Baelos, which is going to give us a 4/4 beast creature token every single time we get a land into play. And of course, we can also utilize a card like Desecrated Tomb to make our army even bigger, because it says whenever one or more creature cards leave your graveyard, create a 1/1 blackback creature token with flying. Essentially how this works with Grawlnok is that when our creatures hit the graveyard, they are then exiled, so they left the graveyard, so Desecrated Tomb is going to give us a bat basically whenever we mill into a creature. So yeah, Grawlnok the Omnivore is, well, you could build it into Frog Tribal if you really wanted to, but Definitely don't get thrown off by that first part. Yes, you can mill when Gronok attacks, but you don't need to build a lot of other frogs around this commander to be effective. In fact, it is a really interesting kind of different take on card advantage in these colors, and yeah, I think it's interesting enough to finish at number 8. Moving on though, it's time for us to go from number 8 to number 7. And coming in at 7th place, we've got Olivia Crimson Bride. Olivia is a 3-4 Vampire Noble with Flying and Haste that costs 4 black red. She has, whenever she attacks, return target creature card from your graveyard to the battlefield. Tapped and attacking, it gains when you don't control a legendary vampire, exile this creature. So Olivia is a fantastically hasty, evasive, reanimating commander. The creature that you reanimate from your graveyard comes back into play, tapped and already attacking, so yeah, you can get some extra combat damage in with that, and you can make some really explosive plays with this. But there is a restriction to this, in that if at one point you don't control a legendary vampire, well, that creature is gone, well, forever. So no more Olivia shenanigans, or at least I should say, no more Olivia shenanigans unless you're prepared. Because obviously if you've got some sort of a sacrifice outlet in play, and yeah, there are plenty in these colors, you could just sacrifice that creature before all your legendary vampires are gone, and it's back in your graveyard to be reanimated by Olivia again. Regardless, of course, in these colors, there are plenty of ways to get a ton of powerful creatures into your graveyard. I mean, you could utilize cards like Ruin Grinder, Final Parting, and Arik Lore Mage to just say a few. Ruin Grinder says when it dies, each player may discard their hand and draw 7 cards, so yeah, if you've got some big powerful creatures in your hand, well, just get them into your graveyard. Final Parting says search your library for 2 cards, put one in your hand and the other in your graveyard, then shuffle your library, so just go get the perfect card for your hand and the perfect creature in your graveyard, and have fun with that. And then Arik Lore Mage is actually a repeatable kind of graveyard tutor, let's say. It says search your library for a card, put it into your graveyard, then shuffle. If it's an instant or sorcery card, put a +1 counter on Arik Lore Mage. Again, it's not going to be instants and sorceries for this deck. You're going to be going getting giant creatures that Olivia is going to help you get back out. And of course, you might choose a giant creature with a huge ETB with something like a Sepulchral Primordial. It has, when it enters the battlefield for each opponent, you may put up to 1 target creature card from that player's graveyard onto the battlefield under your control. So yeah, by just getting this out, and again, it's tapped and attacking, and it's got Intimidate, which I forgot to mention, so this can usually get through on an opponent. On top of that, you are stealing 3 creatures from graveyards to get into play under your control. And yeah, this is basically a build your own board state with just 1 creature. And of course, you can really take advantage of Olivia's attack trigger by getting extra combats with something like Relentless Assault. It says untap all creatures that attack this turn after this main phase, additional combat phase, follow additional main phase. Basically, hey, you get extra combat, okay? So you get to swing twice with Olivia, which means that you get that creature that you initially got, you know, to swing twice as well. And you get another creature that's already going to be tapped and attacking. Have fun. You can also play around though with cards that actually have a major downside on an attack trigger, since Olivia kind of gets around that by making them already come into play tapped and attacking, like, you know, Rakdos the Defiler. It's a 7-6 Flample Demon, Flying and Trample, that has, when it attacks, sacrifice half the non-demon permanents you control rounded up, and whenever it deals combat damage to a player, that player sacrifices half the non-demon permanents they control rounded up. So yeah, that is a way to completely get around that attack trigger by, you know, attacking with Olivia, getting this back out of your graveyard, then it's already tapped and attacking, and you don't get that attack trigger. So while you're not sacrificing anything, your opponents are going to be sacrificing a ton when this hits them. But yeah, I think this is an overall really solid design for a commander. It has a very powerful effect, but there is a restriction to it and a major downside to it. If you don't at some point control a legendary vampire, well, all those creatures that you got back are gone forever. And yeah, I think this commander is pretty fairly costed at 6 mana with such a powerful effect, especially one that you can get right away since this has haste. So yeah, Olivia, it is definitely your big day being the Crimson Bride, and it's also your big day because you finished 7th. But now it's time for us to move away from the Crimson Bride at number 7 and on to number 6. And coming in at 6th place, we've got a completely different commander with Toxrill the Corrosive. Toxrill is a 7-7 Slug Horror, and yeah, this is pretty horrifying, that costs 5 black. It has, at the beginning of each end step, put a slime counter on each creature you don't control. Creatures you don't control get -1/-1 for each slime counter on them. Whenever a creature you don't control with a slime counter on it dies, create a 1-1 black slug creature token. And by paying blue-black, you sacrifice a slug to draw a card. So yeah, this commander is an absolute bomb, and if it sticks around, well, your opponents are going to be in big trouble. It does have a massive converted mana cost at 7 mana, so yeah, you're going to want to make sure that you have a lot of ways to protect this because it's a big investment, but a huge payoff, you know, when it stays around. Because yeah, at the beginning of each and every single end step, including your opponent's end steps, they get slime counters on their creatures. So it's just one trip around the table that's essentially four slime counters on all creatures that you don't control, and yeah, all the creatures are pretty much going to either be wiped out and you get slug tokens, or they're going to be so small that they're pretty insignificant and can't really do much, and they're going to die eventually. You know, on top of this, Commander also allowing you to sacrifice slugs to draw cards. You know, card advantage, good thing. So yeah, obviously Proliferate works very well with this type of a commander to get more and more slime counters on those creatures with things like Tezzeret's Gambit, Thrumming Bird, and Flux Channeler. Tezzeret's Gambit has you draw two cards and proliferate, Thrumming Bird has you proliferate whenever you deal combination to a player, and Flux Channeler says whenever you cast a non-creature spell, proliferate. So yeah, whether it's one-time effects or repeatable effects, you're going to want to make sure you include these in the deck to get more and more slime counters on those creatures to take them out quicker and to get more and more slugs. And speaking of slime counters, we can also utilize Sludge Monster, which is the only other creature in Magic or only other card in Magic that gives slime counters to creatures. It has when it enters the battlefield or attacks, put a slime counter up to one other target creature, and also, more importantly, non-horror creatures with slime counters on them lose all abilities and have base power toughness 2/2. So this works incredibly with our commander, turning all of our opponent's creatures into essentially 2/2s that essentially just need two slime counters on them to get taken out thanks to our commander. And you know, with all of our opponent's creatures getting taken out quite frequently, something like Ogre Slumlord can really help us out too. It has, whenever another non-token creature dies, you may create a 1/1 black rat creature token, and rats you control have death touch, so yeah, not only do we have a slug army, but we also have a rat army too. And like I mentioned before, you're definitely going to want to protect this commander with basically everything you've got, because it has a huge impact when it's in play, but it can also be a big target to get taken out, so yeah, Gift of Doom can really help you out. It says enchanted creature has death touch and indestructible, and you can actually surprisingly just morph this by sacrificing another creature, which again, you're going to have plenty of them, to actually just get this on your commander and protect it. So yeah, Toxrill is an absolutely devastating commander when it's in play, and yeah, I really like the design of it, and make sure you're protecting it because it very well might have a huge target on its back, you know, from all of your opponents. So again, Toxrill the Corrosive, congratulations on your 6th place finish. But we're moving away from this lovely slug in 6th place to number 5. And coming in at 5th place, we're done with slug tokens and we're on to human soldier tokens with Torrens, Fist of the Angels. Torrens is a 2/2 human cleric with training that costs 1 green white. And training is a new mechanic in this set and says whenever this creature attacks with another creature with power greater, put a ++1 counter on this creature. And on top of that, of course, whenever you cast a creature spell, you get a 1/1 green and white human soldier creature token with training. So this is a very simple design for a commander, but I really enjoy it and I actually think it's quite powerful. It's a low to the ground commander that encourages you to cast more and more creature spells, and the more that you do, the more tokens you get, and again, those tokens can grow throughout the game because they have training. It's just overall a very solid design that I think works really well with the new training mechanic. And if you are going to build around this commander, I would highly recommend cards like White Mane Lion, Hamza Guardian Varashin, and Katilda Dawnheart Prime. White Mane Lion has flash, and when it enters the battlefield, return a creature you control to its owner's hand, so yeah, this is one of those types of creatures that you can essentially just keep casting and bouncing back to your hand over and over again. Which is fantastic with a commander that benefits you whenever you cast a creature, so yeah, this is basically just a token-generating creature in combination with your commander. And of course, you can also benefit from cards like Hamza, which reduce the cost of your creature spells. Hamza's gonna cost 1 less to cast for each creature you control with a ++1 counter on it, and creature spells you cast cost 1 less to cast for each creature you control with a counter on it. And again, since our tokens and our commander have training, well, we're easily going to get a lot of counters on them, and yeah, this can make our creature spells cost basically nothing. And the Katilda can help us even more with mana by making human creatures we control have tap at 1 mana of any of this creature's colors. So yeah, build up a giant army, and build up a ton of mana. Of course, you also might want to consider a new card like Laid to Rest, which says whenever a human you control dies, draw a card, and whenever a creature you control with a ++1 counter on it dies, you gain 2 life. So this can help us with a ton of card advantage on top of helping pad our life total. And speaking of card advantage, of course, you can also consider Mentor the Meek, which says whenever the creature in power 2 or less enters the battlefield under your control, you may pay 1 if you do draw a card. And of course, you can utilize one of the many fantastic anthems in these colors like Dictate of Heliod. It has flash and gives creatures you control +2/+2, so now those tiny tokens are getting even bigger on top of their training. Again, I just think that Torrens is a very solid design for a commander and a good use of this new mechanic. You get to go wide while also going big, kind of on their own, essentially. So, Torrens, again, congratulations on your 5th place finish. Moving on, though, let's move from number 5 with Torrens on to number 4. And coming into 4th place, we've got Umbriss Fear Manifest. Umbriss is a 1/1 Nightmare Horror that costs 3 blue-black. Umbriss is going to get ++1 for each card your opponents own in exile, and whenever Umbriss or another Nightmare or Horror enters the battlefield under your control, target opponent exiles cards from the top of their library until they exile a land card. This is a very interesting commander that kind of helps you go in two directions at the exact same time, but both very effectively. Actually, maybe even three directions. Let's analyze. First off, this commander is somewhat like a mill commander. Okay, it's not mill in that it, you know, gets things into your opponent's graveyards, but it's getting them off the top of their library and just gone. So yeah, even more impactful than mill, you know, exiling those cards away. And this does this on ETB or with some sort of a kind of tribal synergy there whenever you have a nightmare or horror enter the battlefield. On top of that, this commander is going to get absolutely massive in pretty much no time, and yeah, it's going to stay massive. Because even if it gets dealt with, well, you're going to be able to get it back in play, you know, when you recast for your command zone, and it's still going to be the exact same power and toughness. Actually, it's going to be even bigger because you're going to target an opponent and have them exile even more cards. So this is kind of like a Voltron slash, you know, mill, but with exile slash, you know, nightmare, horror, you know, tribal kind of commander. Again, you don't want to go in too many different directions, but you can be very, you know, focused in certain directions and still be very impactful with this well-designed commander. So if you want to dig in those tribal synergies, you can definitely utilize some that help you out in other ways like Ravenous Chupacabra, Dread Presence, and Consuming Aberration. Ravenous Chupacabra has when it enters the battlefield, destroy target creature and opponent controls, so that's some nice extra value there. Dread Presence says, whenever a swamp enters the battlefield under your control, choose one, you draw a card and lose one life, or Dread Presence deals 2 damage to any target and you gain 2 life. And then Consuming Aberration is definitely the best out of all these in tribal synergy and just raw power. It says, its power and toughness are each equal to the number of cards in your opponent's graveyard. So this one actually does count graveyards, whereas our commander is going to count exile. That being said, it says whenever you cast a spell, each opponent reveals the top card of their library until they reveal a land card, but then put those cards in their graveyard. So this can mill our opponents even further. You know, our commander is actually exiling, this one's actually milling, but both are getting rid of our opponent's things, so we can actually mill our opponents out pretty quickly. And speaking of that, there's Nightmare Shepherd, which is a 4/4 demon with flying, and it says whenever another non-token creature you control dies, you may exile it. If you do, create a token that's a copy of that creature, except it's a 1/1 and it's a nightmare addition to its other types. So with this, essentially when any of our creatures die, we get a nightmare token to replace them to mill our opponents further. Or again, I should say mill exile, we really need a word for that. And of course, you can also utilize blink effects like Essence Flux to actually blink our commander to protect it, and also to get its ETB again. And yet, a simple card like Rogue's Passage, which can make our commander unblockable, can easily help it be a one-shot kill on an opponent. But yeah, overall, this is just a very interesting commander that can help you go in a few different directions. Again, try to keep it as focused as you can, but there are definitely some cards that, you know, have overlap for multiple directions that can really help out with this interesting commander. So yeah, overall, Umbrus, I think you're a very solid commander, and you have finished at number 4. Next up, though, let's move on to the top 3, starting off, obviously, at number 3. And coming in at 3rd place, we've got Old Rutstein. That's right, Old Rutstein has made it into the top 3. And actually, I do have to admit that one of the main reasons that Old Rutstein made it this far is because I'm a huge fan of Resident Evil 4. I mean, that was one of my favorite games growing up. And this is basically, you know, just that, you know, merchant guy that goes, "What are you buying?" So yeah, that kind of heavily influenced my decision. But you know what? This is my picks for the Golden Pig, so deal with it. Anyways, Old Rutstein is a 1/4 human peasant that costs 1 black-green. When it enters the battlefield or at the beginning of your upkeep, you mill a card, and if a land card is milled this way, you get a treasure token. If a creature card is milled this way, you get a 1/1 insect, and if a non-creature non-land card is milled this way, you get a blood token. So this is pretty much just Druidic Satchel, the commander, and yeah, I'm completely down for that, especially if I can keep saying, "What are you buying?" every time it triggers. So it's definitely not the most powerful commander out there, but it does give you some incremental value. So yeah, if you're going to build around this commander, you might want to utilize a card like Voyager Staff. There aren't too many blink effects in these colors, but if you do blink it, obviously you can save your commander, and obviously get that ETB again. Speaking of which, you can also get that ETB again by protecting with something like Undying Malice, which is basically a new version, which actually already exists with Feign Death, but there's plenty of cards that do this in these colors that basically say until the end of the turn, if the creature dies, it just comes back into play. And of course, we can get extra value from our self-mill with cards like Turn Timber Sower. It says whenever one or more land cards are put in your graveyard from anywhere, you get a 0/1 green plant creature token. And on top of that, of course, we've got cards like Crawling Sensation and the brand new Crawling Infestation. Each of these are essentially going to let us mill 2 at the beginning of our upkeep, so that helps with our commander and obviously with themselves as well. Crawling Sensation says whenever one or more land cards are put in your graveyard from anywhere for the first time each turn, put a 1/1 green insect creature token on the battlefield. Crawling Infestation essentially does the exact same thing, but it counts creatures hitting the graveyard, and unfortunately though it only counts just during our turn, but still it's a nice extra value and it's a great way for us to mill ourselves. And of course, since we're milling ourselves, well, we can include some massive creatures in the deck as well and maybe sacrifice some of those tokens with something like Victimize to, you know, get back some massive creatures. So yeah, reanimation is definitely a direction that you can take this commander as well. But obviously, the main reason that Old Rutstein finished in the top 3 is, well, because again, of my love of Resident Evil 4. I do really like the design of this commander, but
what are you buying?
Really put it over the top. But now let's move away from number three and on to number two. And coming in just short of first place at second place, still a very respectable finish, is Jacob Hawken, Inspector. And I don't know why I say it that way, but I do. Regardless, Jacob Hawken is a 0-2 human advisor that costs 1 and a blue. It has tap, draw a card, then exile a card from your hand face down. You may look at that card for as long as it remains exiled. You may pay 4 blue-blue if you do transform it. And this commander flips into Hawken's Insight. It's a legendary enchantment that says at the beginning of your upkeep, exile the top card of your library face down. You may look at that card for as long as it remains exiled. And then once during each of your turns, you may play a land or cast a spell from among the cards exiled with this permanent without paying its mana cost. So this is a fantastic card selection engine to start with Jacob Hawken in play, you know, just kind of like a merfolk looter in a way. And then when you're ready, you can flip it and get access to all those cards and future cards with Hawken's Insight to basically cast for free once a turn. So yeah, build up your collection of exiled cards and then get some massive things cast for free. It's a really interesting design, and again, I just like the fact that you can get this down early for some early card selection, and then utilize it later in the game for some big plays. So of course, we can utilize Jacob more than once in a turn with untap effects from things like Dramatic Reversal, Retreat to Coral Helm, and Chalk and Retriever. Dramatic Reversal is going to untap all non-land permanents we control, so we can actually net mana on this if we're untapping Mana Rocks as well. And then Retreat to Coral Helm is a repeatable untap effect with Landfall. Whenever a land enters the battlefield under your control, choose one. You may tap or untap target creature or scry one. And speaking of repeatable effects, Chalk and Retriever has, whenever you cast a spell during your turn, untap target creature. So we can keep tapping and untapping and tapping again for some more card selection with our commander. And we can actually turn that card selection into straight up card advantage with a card like Thought Reflection. It says if you would draw a card, draw two cards instead. So now we get to draw two cards and we only exile one from our hand. So yeah, we're gaining card advantage there. And with all this card draw, of course, we can take advantage of a card like Ominous Seas that basically builds up four shadow counters on it, and then we can remove those counters for some giant Kraken creature tokens. And speaking of giant, of course, when we're ready to flip it, well, we can get some massive things into play like, oh, maybe an Eldrazi like Artisan of Kozilek. It says whenever you cast a spell, you may return target creature card from your graveyard to the battlefield. Oh, and it's a 10-9 with Annihilator too. So good luck to your opponents once you get some massive things into play like this. But yeah, I really like the design of this commander, again, giving you that early card selection with the, you know, front side of the commander, and then a big payoff later in the game with Hawken's Insight. So, Jacob Hawken, Inspector, congratulations on your second place finish. But now it's time for us to move from number two to number one. And the winner for the Innistrad Crimson Vow main set and pre-cons Golden Pig Awards is Aruth Tormented Prophet. Aruth is a 2-4 human wizard that costs 1 blue red. She has, if you would draw a card, exile the top two cards of your library instead, you may play those cards this turn. So Aruth essentially turns all of our card draws into double the value, well I should say double the temporary value with impulse draws. She gives us access to twice as many cards, but that access is only temporary. Now there are a lot of ways that you can actually build this commander and a lot of safer ways that you can build her, but I don't want to build in those ways. I want to build this commander with the motto, go big or go home. That's right, we're going to play without a hand. We're going to just go all in and get a ton of cards, you know, that we get access to with impulse draws and make some really big and exciting plays. And if it doesn't work out, well, we don't have a hand and that's okay. So yeah, I absolutely love the design of this commander. Again, basically turning card advantage into temporary card advantage, but twice as much. So again, for those big plays, I'm going to be utilizing cards like Breakthrough, Curse of Obsession, and Magus of the Wheel. Breakthrough says draw four cards, then choose X cards in your hand and discard the rest. And you know what? Again, I don't care about having a hand, so I'm just gonna pay a single blue mana to, you know, instead of drawing four cards, exile the top eight cards of my library and get access to them this turn for one mana. Eight card impulse draw for one mana. Sign me up. And since I don't care about having a hand, well, I'm going to utilize cards like Curse of Obsession. It's an aura curse that we're going to actually curse ourselves with this. It says at the beginning of enchant player's draw step, that player draws two additional cards. And at the beginning of that player's end step, well, they discard their hand. So this gives us access to an additional, again, it would be two, but with our commander, it's four cards, again, temporarily, but it's already temporary anyways with this because, well, we'd be discarding our hand at the end of the turn. Yeah, with this plus our draw, we get access to six cards in a turn without doing anything else. And that's basically just a brand new hand each turn. Speaking of which, how about Magus of the Wheel and other wheel effects, which has, when you sacrifice it, each player discards their hand and draws seven cards. So yeah, again, we don't care about losing our hand because we probably won't have a hand. And yeah, now we draw seven, which turns into 14 impulse draws. So yeah, we can churn and burn through our deck pretty quickly with this. Speaking of which, since we again don't care about casting things from our hand, well, Experimental Frenzy can really help us out too. It says you may look at the top card of your library anytime, you may play the top card of your library, and you can't play cards from your hand. Again, we don't care. And by paying 3 in a red, destroy it. So yeah, basically with this deck, play from anywhere but your hand, you know, from the top of your library, from, you know, exile, anywhere but your hand. And Sage of the Beyond can help you with that. It says spells you cast from anywhere other than your hand cost 2 less to cast, so some nice discounts there. And with all these spells that we're going to be casting very, very quickly and getting access to more and more cards, well, we could start them off with something like a Mind's Desire. It says shuffle your library, then exile the top card of your library. Until end of turn, you may play that card without paying its mana cost, and of course it's got Storm, so we just keep doing this for every single spell that we've cast before this turn. Yeah, this commander can definitely be built in many ways, and definitely in more, you know, I'd say safe ways where you're not just losing your entire hand. But again, the way that I would build it, and I actually might build around this commander, you know, for my personal collection, would definitely be go big or go home, don't care about having a hand, let's just do big explosive things, and you know what? Just go for it. So again, Aruth, congratulations on your victory as the Golden Pig of Innistrad Crimson Vow. So Aruth, make sure you're looking out for that Golden Pig award in the mail, and ensure that you cherish it and display it forever. Again, a big thank you out there to all the commanders that competed for this prestigious award. Unfortunately, there could only be one winner. But luckily, or should I say, unluckily for the commanders that were not mentioned in this award, there is still one more award that is up for grabs. So make sure you're on the lookout for the next award ceremony with the Golden Toilet of Innistrad Crimson Vow in the Innistrad Crimson Vow Precons. Who will win this other, well, not so prestigious award? Well, tune in to find out. But until then, as always, thanks again and have a good one.